Good morning. I want to welcome you to our worship this morning. I'm glad you're here with us. And for everybody who's watching us online, we're glad you're watching us and joining us for our worship this morning. As we begin this morning, there's a few announcements that I want to lift up. We will have prayer gathering tomorrow morning at 7 a.m. So if you would like to come and pray with us tomorrow morning, we'll be here at 10 or 9? 9. Okay. Just so we're clear. So we'll have prayer at 9. If you have any prayer requests and would like us to be in prayer for you, we have a prayer box right here with some prayer cards. Just fill out one of those cards and put it in the box and we'll be in prayer for you. Next Saturday night at 7 o'clock, we will have our Christmas Eve candlelight service that will be here in our sanctuary. We invite you to come and to celebrate the birth of Christ. That's Saturday night at 7 p.m. And then on church, then on Sunday morning, we'll have just one service at 9 a.m., and it will be a short communion service. So if you would like to come and celebrate once again the resurrection or the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ and celebrate with Holy Communion, we invite you to come. That's tomorrow morning. Or next Sunday morning. Breathe. Next Sunday morning at 9 a.m. We will also have a combined service at 10 a.m. on Sunday, January 1st as well. And for that, Kay Dahl has an announcement to make.
I am very pleased to announce that we have a new pastor. He's coming in January the 1st, and so we're not going to miss a beat after Doug leaves. And the gentleman's name is Dr. Brian Straub. He's from Columbus, Ohio. He's very energetic, and his bio and his picture will be on Facebook and also in the newsletter. And I guess we'll all meet him together. So thank you very much. Interim. Sorry, he is the interim pastor, and he will be here until we can get a permanent pastor. Thank you.
Okay. And I will say I know Brian, and Brian is a fantastic pastor. So. I think he will be able to begin to lead you into the next series in the coming months. So I'm excited for you. He's an excellent pastor. Brian was once the conference secretary for the annual conference. So you know he's good. So you'll like him. The last thing is tonight at. Tonight at 5 o'clock at Ralphie's, the youth will be having their Christmas party. So all of our youth in grades 6 through 12 will be are invited to come to that. And there is a White Elephant gift exchange, $10 limit.
We're not going to call it White Elephant; it's just a $5.
$5.
Bring a gift, and we'll go from there.
Okay, so that's for all of our youth in grades 6 through 12. Are there any other announcements that need to be made at this time? Don't forget, following our worship service this morning, we will be having a dinner. We'll have a meal downstairs, food provided by 101 Smokehouse and Lori Paul. So we invite you to stay for that as well. Let us quiet our hearts as we prepare for worship.
Thank you.
And I invite you, as you are able, to stand for our call to worship. We gather today to worship the one who created us,
the one who calls us,
the one who equips us,
the one who sends us,
the one who loves us without end. And now the praise team will lead us in worship. Come, Holy One, come and make the door to heavens open and come to us. Let the mountains tremble and the seas roar and our hearts open. Come, Holy One, come. Show your face to us once again and echo your name in our hearts and establish peace on earth. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Amen. Please be seated. Oh. The prophet Isaiah wrote, Isaiah said that the Lord spoke to the king and said, Ask a sign of the Lord your God. Let it be deep as Sheol or high as heaven. But when the king refused, God would not be stopped. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the young woman is with child and shall bear a son and shall name him Emmanuel. God wants us to know, even when we aren't sure of ourselves. God wants us to experience God's presence, even when we think that we can handle life on our own. God sends us signs of God's presence with us. All we need to do is to keep our eyes open and look. The gospel writer Matthew said, look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel, which means God with us. And when Joseph woke from his sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord had commanded. He took Mary as his wife, but they had no marital relations until she had borne a son, and he named him Jesus. And so we light these candles, the candles of joyous hope, of proclaimed peace, of deep and everlasting joy, and today, the presence that speaks of love, as a sign that no matter our circumstances, we know we are not alone.
Thank you.
Our scripture lesson this morning comes from the 16th chapter of the Gospel of John. They kept asking, "What does this mean, a little while?" We don't understand what he is saying. As we go to prayer this morning, we want to continue to keep in our prayers those who are on our prayer list. So we continue to pray for Judy Williams and LifeWise Academy, for Martha Bash, for Dick Terrell, Kathy Bash. We want to continue to pray for Sheriff Everhart and Judy Librick and Gloria Oates. We've also been asked to pray for Amy Cradlack, who is unfortunately at home with pneumonia. So we want to keep Amy in our prayers as well. Are there other prayer requests that you'd like to lift up this morning?
Yeah, we had visitors this week from North Carolina, Terry's sister and brother-in-law, so can safe travel for them as they travel back this morning, and also continue to remember my brother, Marty, and well, both brothers, my brother Marty and my brother Greg.
Or my Aunt Carolyn, who recently had a knee replacement surgery. She is doing okay. She had some critical issues with high sugar and oxygen levels, but she's home now, so just praying that things will continue in the right direction.
Okay, and what was her first name?
Carolyn.
My son Carson and our whole entire family for a health issue.
Okay.
If we could remember Lou Downey and his family, we prayed for him a few weeks ago and the news from his CAT scan was not what we wanted it to be.
Are there any others? And let's bow our heads as we go to God in prayer. Our Father God, we thank you and we praise you today for the miracle of your Son's birth. We thank you for bringing joy to the world, for giving us assurance that because you came to us in the form of a human, that we who believe in Jesus can know with absolute certainty that we will spend eternity with you. We thank you, Lord, for many reasons that we have been given a Merry Christmas. And we rejoice for each blessing. We thank you, Lord, for new life, new love, a home, a job, new opportunities, and second chances. We know, Lord, that you bring the sun and the moon to set, and you set the stars in motion. You tell the oceans where to stop, where the snow to start. And we thank you for the mighty gift of your creation. We thank you, Lord, for spiritual leaders and faith-filled friends who keep encouraging us when we are close to giving up. And although we have many reasons to rejoice today, we also know that this season can be not so merry for a whole lot of reasons. And so we pray for those who are experiencing loss during Advent, relational, financial, spiritual, physical loss. We pray for those who are coping with loving a prodigal and our friends and family members whose hearts are far from you. We pray, Lord, for those who are dealing with unemployment, with addictions and chronic sickness. We pray for those who have unending pain and frustrations of all kinds. We thank you, Lord, that you are the wonderful counselor and the Prince of Peace, even in the midst of our not so merry circumstances. And finally, Lord, we ask you to grant us peace. Peace in our homes, peace in our churches, peace in our hearts. When all of the world around us is spinning out of control, still our hearts and let us know that you are God. So, Lord, help us to stay focused on you this Advent season and always. And we thank you for loving the whole world enough to send the greatest gift of all time, your Son, Jesus, so that we may have a very Merry Christmas. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now let us join together in praying the prayer which our Lord has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So now it's time for our moments with the children. So if our children want to come forward this morning.
Hey, girls, you want to come up here for the children's message? Then you can go down there, okay? You can come up here. Is this all my kids? Yeah? All right. Hi, Miss Josie. Can I sit right here beside you? We even have a warm blanket with us. This is nice. Okay, so last weekend, do you guys want to go sit right here? A couple of you guys were here. Do you remember what we did last weekend at Kids Club? What did we do last weekend? Livy? We made cards. But what celebration did we have? Jesus. We had a birthday party for Jesus last weekend, didn't we, Liza? Do you remember the birthday party? Well, what did we do at the birthday party? Do you remember one thing? What did we eat?
Cake.
We had cake at the birthday party. And cookies? Cookies are good, too, at birthday parties. But this time, we had cake at the birthday party. Was there balloons? Yeah. Was there games? Yes, we made some cards. So if you didn't get a card from the Kids Club, just get with me after church because we'll get you one. You did? That's awesome. So there was one thing that we didn't have at the birthday party, and this week I was like, oh my goodness, we did not get a birthday present for Jesus. So can you guys help me? I brought a few things from Kaysen's stash at home that maybe Jesus might like. A ball. Do you think Jesus would like a ball? No. Maybe I have something better in here. Okay. This is a good one. A monster truck. No? Jesus wouldn't like a monster truck? The Kaysen likes monster trucks. All right. Okay, what about a combine? And it's even a red one. No? No? Terry Minter? No? Okay. Maybe if I would have bought a green one, then maybe Jesus would have liked that one. Okay, this is the new fad, so maybe Jesus would like this. A poppet.
No.
No? Okay. I have one more thing in my bag, and I think that this might be what Jesus would like. Okay, does anybody have any guesses? No? Do you know what Jesus wants the most of all? He wants our hearts. He wants you to say, Jesus, please come into my heart, and I'm going to love you forever just like you love me. So can you guys just give your hearts to Jesus this week and always? Yeah? And you have a Jesus book. That's perfect. A Bible? That's awesome. Oh, that's good. That's good. That is good. Okay, let's go ahead and pray, you guys. You bow your heads. Can you guys repeat after me for this prayer? You ready? Dear God, thank you so much for sending baby Jesus for us. sending baby Jesus for us. We love you.
We love you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
And now from Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians, he writes, "Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you. You who care for you in the Lord and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard and love because of their work. Live in peace with each other. And we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive, encouraging the disheartened, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not treat prophecies with contempt. But test them all. Hold on to what is good. Reject every kind of evil. And may God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." Since its airing in 1983, the series finale of the award-winning show MASH was entitled Goodbye, Farewell, and Amen. And this episode still, even today, remains the single most watched episode of television of all time. When it was first aired, there were 125 million viewers. Now, many of you all remember the series MASH. It was set in the middle of Korea, in the Korean War, and it followed the daily exploits of the surgeons and nurses of the MASH 4077. This was an Army surgical hospital that was located just 3 miles from the front line of the war zone. And amidst the horrors of war and all the wounded soldiers, the snipers, the bullets, the bombs and the incompetent army guidelines, the doctors and the nurses relied on humor, hijinks, and hearts of compassion to keep themselves sane. And through their common experience, the members of the 4077th MASH became a tight, close-knit family. And so in this final episode, Goodbye, Farewell, Amen, the community finally receives the good news that they're going home. The war is finally over. And so, it's cause for great joy and celebration. The doctors, but as they rejoice at the news, the doctors and the nurses soon begin to realize that life is going to be different. That their relationships will end as they depart for their various destinations in the United States. And the one who struggled with it the most was B.J. Honeycutt. You remember B.J. was Hawkeye's tent mate, right? And he just could not bring himself to say goodbye. He doesn't want to say those two simple words because for him, it creates a sense of finality. He knows that saying goodbye means that he will probably never see his best friend again, and that they'll have to live without that daily friendship that they've become so accustomed to during the war. And so BJ opts to pretend that he and Hawkeye will keep in touch with Christmas cards and annual visits to medical conventions, and they'll visit each other's homes. And who can blame him for feeling that way? I mean, many of us, including me, can identify with the anxiety, the pain, the sadness, the reluctance towards saying those two words. The two words that acknowledge the end of a particular relationship in a certain setting. Saying goodbye to a friend and to a mentor is not easy. It's extremely difficult. And once the words are spoken, a person then has to learn how to live without the other in their daily midst. This type of dramatic change is scary. I mean, just think about the 12 disciples, how likely they experienced that same sort of fear and anxiety when Jesus said to them in that upper room that he was, when they was having dinner. And I can imagine their shocked faces and their tears and the twittering in their hands when they heard their teacher talk of betrayal, arrest, and even crucifixion. Jesus doesn't let them dwell long there in their fear for very long. He doesn't let them dwell in the fear of what's going to happen to them, and he assures the disciples that they will not be abandoned. He said, when the Holy Spirit, when the Spirit of truth comes, the Spirit will guide you into all the truth. For the Spirit will not speak on its own, but will speak whatever it hears, and the Spirit will declare to you the things that are to come. One author writes that Jesus' announcement of his imminent departure leaves the disciples anxious and distressed. The blow of this announcement, however, is softened by extraordinary words of assurance and promise. Disciples will not be abandoned. They will not be left to fend for themselves. For you see, after Jesus returns to God, the Paraclete, the Holy Spirit, will be sent in his name and will accompany them in their continued life and their mission together in this world. The teaching role of the Holy Spirit is to pass on the tradition of what Jesus said and did without corruption, but yet also reveal the mind of Christ in new situations. While the words of Jesus' assurance and promise of the coming Spirit may not make departure less difficult, the words do give us hope in the midst of change. Jesus' words lifts that heavy weight of finality that is often felt when someone says goodbye. And the presence of the Holy Spirit allows time for both parties who depart from each other to reflect on the sacredness of the moment of change. Another pastor points out that often it is the transitions in life that are the greatest occasions for growth. In addition to appreciating what we are learning and what we are moving to, we learn many secrets of the Spirit by monitoring the experience of the transition itself. We can discover new things about ourselves. We discover new things about the God who is with us in transitions. And my hope, my prayer, is that we will discover the same amazing things about ourselves and from God upon my departure from Walnut Grove and move to Continental. For you see, when I move, when I leave, we'll almost immediately begin to discover that I will not be able to relate to you in the same way that I have been for the last 5.5 years as your appointed pastor, who is daily active and present in the life of the congregation and in the Sunday morning worship services. After today, I will not be in a position to provide pastoral care. I will not be in a position to talk about church business, to perform baptisms, weddings, funerals. I will not be able to serve the church members. I won't be able to answer questions about church programs or supply leaders with resources or help church leaders discern ministry issues they're facing. And friends, after working so closely with all of you, that is going to be difficult. And it's going to be difficult for all of us. John Mahan, in his book, Saying Goodbye, writes this: the pastor ceases to be pastor friend and becomes friend only. Members cease being associates, clients, and advocates, and friends, and also become friends only. Relationships must be redefined as a friendship alone, apart from my ecclesiastical role. The depth of mutual loss and grief is oftentimes so great, the inherent difficult changing, shifting of these roles and the redefining of these relationships becomes compounded by mutual pain. But shift and redefine they must be. And the more intentionally and clearly those roles and shifts are made, the sooner the pastors and members alike can establish new and healthy relationships. So friends, it's going to take time for both you and me to get used to this shift in our relationship. And so I want you to know that I love you all enough to let you go and to be the church that God is calling you to be. I'm letting you go to be Walnut Grove Methodist Church with memories of my ministry here, but without me as your pastor. And all that I ask in return is that you love me enough to let me go, to be the person, to be the pastor that God is calling me to be. A United Methodist pastor who will always hold the memories of this church in my heart as I begin to serve a new call as pastor of Continental United Methodist Church. You will be receiving a new pastor, and I urge you to love that pastor just as you have loved me. For if you love your new pastor as much as you have loved me, it will be the best affirmation of my ministry with you that it was a healthy, a strong, and enduring relationship. It has been my main prayer in this ministry to deepen your commitment to Jesus Christ, to his church, to his mission, and your continued leadership in this congregation will be the best tribute to my ministry. Remember Paul's parting message to the church in Thessalonica. We appeal to you, brothers and sisters, to respect those who labor among you and have charge of you in the Lord and admonish you. Esteem them very highly in love because of their work. Be at peace among yourselves. And we urge you, beloved, to admonish the idlers, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, be patient with them all. See that none of you repays evil for evil. There it is. But always seek to do good to one another and to all. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God for you in Jesus Christ. Do not quench the spirit and do not despise the words of the prophet, but test everything and hold fast to what is good and abstain from all that is evil. Friends, I want you to hold fast to those farewell words of the Apostle Paul. The final message of his letter beautifully describes what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ in the midst of change. For you see, being a follower of Christ is about loving others, encouraging the faint-hearted, helping the weak, and being patient with all people. It's about avoiding vengeance, and it's about seeking good for all. It's about rejoicing, praising, and thanksgiving to God for all that God has done. It's also about making room for the Spirit to flow and to carry us on paths that fulfill God's vision for a more just and peace-filled world. It's about constantly moving forward in love to witness the ever-changing, ever-redeeming, ever-reforming, ever-shaping, reshaping kingdom of God that is being established in creation. It's about pushing past our complacency and stagnancy so that the Church Universal, God's ambassadors of love, can continually grow and be the best ever-stretching hands, feet, arms, legs, heart, and body of Christ in the world. To do the thing God intends for us to do, we must open our eyes to see the change, no matter how painful, no matter how difficult it may seem at the time. So we look at this as a new beginning rather than an end. And it starts, ironically enough, when we begin observing the deeper meaning of the heart, and the heart of that word goodbye. A woman with a scarf over her head hoists her 6-year-old up on the first step of the school bus. She says goodbye. A father on the phone with his freshman son who has just finished bawling him out for poor grades. There's mostly silence at the other end of the line. Well, goodbye, says the father. The noise of the traffic drowns out the sound of the word, but the shape of it lingers on the old man's lips. He tries to look vigorous and resourceful as he holds out his hand to the older man. Goodbye. This time they say it so nearly in unison that it makes them both smile. It was a long while ago that the words, God be with you, disappeared into the word goodbye. But every now and again, some trace of that still lingers through. And in these recent weeks, I have seen traces of God with you glimmer through the various ways in which you have shared your goodbyes with me, from tearful and heartfelt conversations to emails to cards of affirmation. And it's those simple, powerful acts of goodbye that remind me of God's wondrous presence in our lives over these past 5.5 years. And you've seen them too. Those glimmering traces of God's presence, like Sunday morning worship and kids club, pastors' Bible studies, prayer meetings, worship services, weddings, mission projects, funerals, baptisms, confirmation. Those glimmering traces of God's presence have made me a better person, a better father, a better pastor, and a better Christ follower. And those glimmering presence of God and those glimmering traces of God's presence have shaped me and will continue to shape all of you to be the loving and passionate people that God calls you to be. About 15 years ago, my children's mother, she gave me a Father's Day present. And the Father's Day present were 5 tickets to the musical Wicked. Some of you have seen that play. It's kind of a backwards twist on the Wizard of Oz. At the end of the play, Glinda, the Good Witch of the North, and Elphaba, the Wicked Witch of the West, are coming together, and they're saying goodbye. Their final song goes like this. I've heard it said that people come into our lives for a reason, bringing something we must learn. And we are led to those who help us to grow if we let them, and we help them in return. Well, I don't know if I believe that's true, but I know I'm who I am today because of you. It well may be that we will never meet again this lifetime. So let me say this before we part. So much of me is made of what I've learned from you. And you'll be with me like a handprint on my heart. And now, whatever way our stories end, I know that you have rewritten mine by being my friend. And while there is no guarantee that any of us will ever see each other again, I do believe that the glimmering traces of God's presence will forever connect us, will forever illuminate the separate paths that we travel to do the work of Christ. And so, my dear friends, God be with you. Farewell. Amen.
Our church family is ever-changing. Loved ones are born into our family, and loved ones come to an end of their lives. Individuals come and go in our family, in our church life. It is important and right that we recognize these times of passage, of endings and beginnings. Today we celebrate the gifts you have brought us as our pastor. Hear Paul's words written to the Ephesians.
Well, I'm going to try to speak this. Each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ until all of us come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity for the measure of the full stature of Christ. Ephesians 4, 7 through 13.
Today, we share the time of farewell with Pastor Doug, whose time as our pastor ends. Now, he sent this to us, and we're kind of reading on it, and the next thing says he / she, so I don't know, Doug. I had to just throw that in, sorry. He was installed as our pastor on July the 1st, 2017, as a minister of word and sacrament of this congregation. We heard this scripture and we made vows to one another. You were changed to proclaim the gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, to instruct us from the word of God, to admonish us, to comfort us, to reprove us. Your promise to administer the sacraments, to share the responsibility for our mutual Christian growth, and to exercise Christian love and discipline. You were charged to be a loyal witness to the United Methodist Church and to further its mission in the world. We, in turn, promised to receive the word of truth you proclaimed and to submit with cheer to the pastoral care you provided. We promised to encourage you and pray for you, to participate and work for you, and to financially care for you. Paul's words, calling to which you have been called with all humanity and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all, from Ephesians.
I thank you, my sisters and brothers, for the love, the kindness, and the support you have shown me these past 5.5 years. I'm grateful for the ministry that we have shared together, and with joy, I recall what we accomplished with God's help, and with sadness, those dreams left not fulfilled. I ask your forgiveness for mistakes made and expectations not met.
We offer our forgiveness and celebrate all that God has accomplished among us. We are grateful for your ministry and for your influence on our lives. We ask your forgiveness for mistakes made and for expectations not met.
I receive your gratitude and I forgive your shortcomings. and I release you from the vows and the promises I made when I came to you as pastor.
We release you from your promises to us, and we offer you your blessings as you leave to minister elsewhere. O God, you have bound us together for a time as pastor and people to work for your church in this place. We give you thanks for the ministry we have shared.
We give you thanks for your patience with us despite our blindness and slowness of heart. We thank you for your forgiveness and mercy when we have failed.
We especially thank you for your never-failing presence with us through these years and for the deepened knowledge of you and of each other.
We give you thanks for those who have been joined to this part of Christ's family through baptism. We thank you for opening our hearts and minds again and again to your word and for feeding us abundantly at your table. We remember those who have gone before, and we look with hope toward those who will come.
Now we pray, be with Pastor Doug and with his family and with this congregation. Grant that all of us, by drawing closer to you, may always be close to each other in the communion of saints. All this we ask for the sake of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen.
I'm going to try to get through this. Before I totally lose it, I'm going to tell you, we want you to all come down and enjoy this fellowship time. Afterwards, we're going to eat together, have some wonderful food. Pastor Doug's going to give the blessing before we go downstairs so that we can eat right away be two lines and probably go down this way. But please stay and fellowship. There was a box downstairs to leave a note for Doug. If you forgot to make a card, I put sheets of paper down there and pens, crayons, and pencils if you want to write a note to Doug. But Doug, this is our time to give back to you, to let you know that you spoke to us and we listened. You led us the last 5.5 years through some incredible times. The pandemic, we never missed a beat. He quickly learned to put the worship service online. He did extra services through that initial pandemic online, so we didn't lose our focus through all of that. The disaffiliation was an incredible process, and even Brian Straub said, "We owe you a debt of thanks for your leadership. You made us better, incredibly better. And you have left your imprint on us. And now, something very special for you. Of course, Lisa, a rock star upstairs. This totally was not me. But with the help of a lot of people, especially your mother, Lisa put together a video. And it's just really quite incredible. She really went over the top. So, Lisa, I think we're ready.
There. Pastor Doug, Michael W. Smith here. I hear you have run a marathon and finished well, and I'm just here to tell you congratulations. You probably will never know, and neither will I, you know, the ministry impact that we have on people, but thanks for being faithful. There's a lot of people who love you, and they like the song Friends, so maybe one day I can do a special concert for you, Pastor Doug. But mainly just reaching out to say congrats, and you've been an inspiration to so many, and I applaud you and celebrate you today. God bless.
But we'll keep you close as
We'll have a talk. And why didn't you all tell me I was so fat? Anyway, we receive the benediction. Unto God's gracious mercy, we commit you. The Lord bless you, the Lord keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. Both this day and forever. Amen. And now will you join me in prayer as we pray our blessing on our meal. Our gracious God, we offer our thanks for this time of worship, this time of celebration. And we pray, Lord, that as we fellowship with one another in our meal together downstairs, we pray that you will just bless us and let us rejoice in the what you are doing in our midst. Bless the food, the hands that have prepared it, as we give you glory and honor in the strong name of Jesus. Amen. Go in peace.